I used to think this was just like the version of Mary that the Mexican people liked. Like I thought I just thought that, well, we all have our versions of Mary, and some guy from Mexico painted a picture of her, and this is their version of her. I never knew it was a supernatural image with all kinds of miracles and stuff going on in the image, and that there were hidden discoveries that we only just found out because we have the technology to know that secretly hidden in the Tilma for the last 500 years, God has been waiting so we would have the advancements of our technology, of advanced Kepler's mathematics, NASA software to show us all of the stars in the sky from any latitude and longitude in the world. He's waiting to show us there's hidden images of people in her eyes. That her eyes acts like a living eyeball. It's called the Sanson-Purkinje effect. Remember when you learned in school that when you look at somebody, the image of the person you're looking at is in three places in your eye and one of them turns upside down? Which is the weirdest thing. Why would our eyeballs turn something upside down? Seems like it's a lot more work for our brain to do to turn it right back side up, right? I mean, first of all, we got to consolidate everything you see in this eye and everything you see in this eye to make one picture. So, I don't know. But anyways, her eyes do that. That's just incredible that there's been miracles, like people have been healed when they have come in the presence of the Tilma, that battles have been won when they had put the image, that when people were dying in the plague. Anybody watch Monty Python? Bring out your dead, bring out your dead, right? This is what was happening. People were dying of the plague. It's just a flesh wound, you know what I'm talking about, right? And they carried the image in the streets, and people were healed. Like, what is going on? This is exciting. We want miracles. So before I tell you this really awesome story, I want us to get an idea of why Mary's important. Because you know what? As Catholic Christians, you're going to get attacked a lot. People are going to think you worship Mary. They're going to think, like, we have some weird, strange relationship with her. And that we're just not going to Jesus. Why don't you just go to Jesus? So I want to help you understand the importance of Mary, okay? So I'm gonna need some volunteers. Or I'm gonna need some older volunteers. So you giggling, you get the get out and bring up the dead thing, right? You can't appear for me. I need you to be God the Father for me, okay? Remember to get your Christians, we also know he's in the tabernacle, so we're going to play a little bit, he's going to play with us, but we're still just going to be reverent when we come up. So, Jesus, we're going to play a little bit, but we know you love joy, and you love excitement and playfulness, so no irreverence, Lord. We're here to just talk about the awesomeness of your mother. So, what's your name, sir?
Dan.
Is it Dan or just Dan? I'm just teasing. Okay, Dan, what year are you in school? It's Dane. I was way off. Okay, so Dane. And now you're going to be God the Father for me, okay? So God the Father, we see these beautiful pictures that your father, the priest here at this parish, put up. Creator of the universe. I want you to go like this and put your hands up. You're creating. No, that's not creating the awesomeness of the universe. We want to hear angels saying, Lord, you are creating the universe. They were intensity, I'm pretty sure. Gonna get intense. It's too early. All right, another tall guy. Tall. What's the next tall guy? Right there in the green. You look pretty tall. Right? Yeah, you look behind yourself. Yep, that's you. Come on out. Remember to genuflect. I want you to put your arms out. You're creating the universe. There you go. Now you are God the Son. All right. You are giving yourself as a gift. Gift, a faithful gift, a fruitful gift, bringing life, a total gift of yourself, pouring out. And you, Jesus the Son, are receiving the gift of the Father. And I'm going to have you turn this way. This is going to make more sense if we do it this way. We come this way. It's like London Bridge. Put your hands like this together. God is giving himself, and he's pouring his love out. And Jesus, we know know on the cross that he gave himself as a free gift to us. Nobody takes my life, I lay it down. A total gift of himself, a faithful gift and a fruitful gift because it gave us spiritual life. And now I need another guy, another guy, another guy, another guy, another guy. Right there at the end, you come on this way. You're God, the Holy Spirit. You're going to genuflect before you come up here. Show a little reverence to Jesus. There you are. Not this Jesus, that Jesus. Okay, so you come in here, you're going to stand in there. You're going to turn this way. You're going to put your arms out. Out, out, there you go. Just like this. Just like this. So here is a view of the Trinity, okay? God is pouring out his love to the Son. The Son is receiving the gift of the Father, and he's pouring his love back. And the fire of the love between them is so great. It is the third person of the Holy Trinity. And his love is pouring itself out into the world. Pouring itself out into the world. And so then I'm going to take, is there a husband and wife here? Any husbands and wives? I need a husband and a wife. Oh, come on. Adam and Eve. I don't want to embarrass any kids by pairing them up. So we're going to do a married couple. Adam and Eve. And love creates. Love creates. And love created Adam and Eve. Give a little holla to Jesus there. There you go. All right. All right. So Eve is going to grab hold of the Holy Spirit. I'm here. Is Father still with us or did he leave? All right. Father, I'm going to need you to be the devil for me. So you come up here. Okay. The two of you are joined together. Look at this beautiful, beautiful image of the Trinity. Beautiful image of the Trinity.
Trinity. And the new way Eve
And so it begins that once again we can begin to pour out the love. Okay, so let's give our Trinity model a round of applause. In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
I renounce the lie.
I renounce the lie.
That I am Satan.
That I am Satan.
All right, amen. Thanks. All right. So Mary for us is the new Eve. That she is restoring what was broken with original sin. And through her yes, we have gained a great Savior. Mary is so important, and it couldn't have just been any kind of girl coming along. Because God makes all things new. It had to be someone that was immaculately conceived. Was Mary immaculately conceived? Yes, and what does that mean? What does that mean that she was immaculately conceived? Right there, sir. She was not just born without sin, she was conceived without sin. So the moment that her body knit in her womb and God infused an immortal soul, because we create the matter, God creates our immortal soul. Did you know that out of all the people God could have created, he chose you? Like, he could have chosen anybody, but he chose you. And guess what? He knew what he was getting when he made you. Like, y'all are no surprise to God, okay? Like all the times that you're like, oh, I'm not good enough, I'm not smart enough, or I'm ugly, I'm fat, I'm short, I'm tall, I'm whatever, you know, all of these, because we all think this way. You're laughing, but you know it's true. You know, you've been playing sports, and you've been like, you hear the devil telling you all the reasons why you're not worthy. We're not worthy, but we are worthy. We are worthy. And God knew what he was getting when he made you. You ever have that devil telling you why you're not worthy? You say, God knew what he was getting when he made me. So you go take it up with him. He, for whatever reason, thought I was valuable enough to make me. And he's got a plan for my life. And one person can change the world. Did you know that? One of you. Each and every single one of you sitting here can change the world. Look it, I'm one person. I travel around the world. I speak to thousands and thousands and thousands of people. Do you not think that what I'm doing is making an impact? The world it is. Maybe you're called to do the same thing. Maybe you're going to be a singer. Maybe you're going to be the president. Maybe you're going to save lives and be a doctor. I don't know what that thing is, but God does. And he has a plan for all of us. And he wants you to be in a relationship with him. He doesn't want you to just come here to church and genuflect and go through the motions and get in the pew and then get up and go home and do all the things that you do on a regular basis. He wants us to be woken up and he wants us to know he's a real God, he's alive, and he wants to know you, and he wants you to know him, and he wants you to love him, and he wants to love you, and he wants to serve with you, through you, and for you, and he wants you to serve him with your yes, because ultimately we're all made for union and communion with him in heaven. Isn't that awesome? I mean, we're made for relationship. God is a relationship of love, life-giving love. And we have been made for relationships. If we don't have people in our lives that we know loves us, cares for us, and we feel safe with, then our hearts hurt. They ache. It hurts. We're not made for loneliness. God made Adam, and he walked around looking, and he said, hey, everybody's got somebody but me. I'm all alone. Don't you think it's interesting? Because, you know, when God created the earth, he created, you know, all the water and the dark and the light and the water and the land, and then but when he created the animals, it's not like he created like all the boy turkeys and then put the boy turkeys asleep and then took like a wishbone out of the turkey and made a girl turkey. You know what I'm saying? Like, he created all of the animals, male and female, at the same time. He didn't like make them wait, but with human beings, he made Adam walk around for a little while, being like, I'm holy, this sucks. Why did he do that? Why did he make Adam wait?
He said he didn't know.
Some of church theologians say that he made him wait because the gift of woman was going to be so awesome. He had to stretch his heart with a longing and loneliness just to make room for the awesome gift that he was going to bring with woman. just to make sure you got how awesome we are. I'm just saying. And it was to create that ache. Anybody watch the double rainbow guy?
It's like a triple rainbow.
You know what I'm talking about? You seen the double rainbow guy on YouTube? If you haven't, you've got to watch it. Because I imagine that is how Adam felt when he saw Eve for the first time. Oh, what does it mean? He's like bawling. It's almost triple rainbow. You know what I'm talking about? This guy is freaking out over this gorgeous rainbow in the sky. And I imagine, like, when Adam saw Eve for the first time, he was like, and it says in the Bible, he exclaimed, blood of my blood and flesh of my flesh and bones of my bones. Like, we don't talk that way now. Like, in Song of Songs, they also talks about, like, the perfect, lovely lady having the back of a nose like Lebanon. Like, I don't want a nose like Lebanon. So the language is different, but the exclamation is the same. Like, whoa! This is amazing! We don't get excited like that anymore. Maybe with Xbox, right? Or you get these awesome new shoes or like the latest iPhone, right? Or gadgets. We get like, this is so great! But God wants us to be that excited about each other, about people, about persons. So I want you to just consider for a moment, listening to this awesome love story, this invitation from God the Father, where He will work miracles and crazy stuff to prove He exists and He's real. And He knows us, and He wants each and every one in this room to realize how unique and unrepeatable we are, and how much He desires for us to enter into His plan to save the world, to bring people to Him. Each and every one of you, He has given gifts and charisms specific to whatever He's calling you to do with your life. Even your name. You think your mom picked your name because, and your dad, because they liked it, or because it was Uncle Joe's, or whatever. No. The Holy Spirit picked your name and inspired it in your parents to pick that name for you. And our names reveal God's purpose for us. That's all in the Bible. Names are so important. Emmanuel, God is with us. Saul's name was changed to Paul because God knew how important names were. Names are important. Your name is important. You want to talk to me afterwards? I'll talk to you about your names. My name is Christina Marie King. Christina King like Christ the King, huh? How coincidental is it that I go around talking about Jesus Christ when I got Christ in my name? How coincidental is it that my middle name is Marie, which is the French form of Mary, and I go around talking about Mary? Oh, it's a coincidence. No, it's not. Our names reveal part of our purposefulness because God does everything for a reason, and yes, everything means something. So let's listen a little bit to this love story between God and us, okay? So, I'm going to start. We don't need to read the words. But how did almost 10 million people get converted in less than 10 years? 10 million people. How did that happen? It happened when God, in the Tilma, using this image, wrote a personal invitation to the Aztec people, the Nahuatl Indians. And in this image, because it was in a language of glyphs, how many of you have heard of hieroglyphs? Hieroglyphs from Egypt? Yeah, you've heard of them. They didn't have the ABCs, they had hieroglyphs pictures. So did the Aztec Empire. And so using glyphs, using pictures, it reads like a book. If we could read Nahuatl glyphs, we would get up and we would read, in the beginning, it says, God, the greater than the sun God, greater than the moon God, the one true God, born of a virgin Mary, born of a virgin mother, This divine God is coming to them from the heavens at this particular time in history, because it's a calendar, it's the Mayan calendar. This is also a calendar. And there is going to be blood and water that will be food for them to eat. And it will give them life-giving waters in which he is going to create a new civilization of love. And that they're supposed to go to the man with a pointy hat, known as the bishop in that area, who was a great wise man and shaman with knowledge beyond understanding of the earthly realm, to teach them and to give them this life-giving waters. That's what it says. Like, I'm not kidding. How did he say it? Let me show you. Everything in the image means something. And it begins with this. This is called the Nahui Olin. It is a four-petal jasmine flower. And it's right there on the Tilma, on her womb. This at her waist is called cincture. Cinctures were worn by virgins. But when you got married and you had children, it would get changed and moved high to indicate that you were pregnant. But because of the way she's wearing it and the kind of what she's wearing, it says she's virgin and pregnant. And that the child in her womb is the one true God that prophesied and foretold as the story through Quetzalcoatl, it was called, who is going to arrive and come back. And in fact, Montezuma, who was the leader of the Aztec Empire, how many of you watched the Apocalypse Now by Mel Gibson? You should watch it. I mean, it's a little, like, bloody. But it's a really great history lesson. Mel Gibson, it's called Apocalypse Now or Apocalypto. And he shows the Aztec Empire, the Mayan Empire, and what was happening. See, Montezuma, they had these false gods, and the greatest of them was the sun god. And they believed that if they didn't take the hearts out of human beings and eat the flesh of them, that they would not have the powers that they need, and the sun would not rise, and the crops wouldn't grow in the field, and they wouldn't have food. But because this was also a Mayan calendar, they knew they were coming to the end of an age. Remember 2012, everybody was saying, like, it's the end of the Mayan calendar, something bad's gonna happen. Well, that's what they thought. They thought something bad was gonna happen December 12th of the year 1531, because it was the end of the Mayan calendar. So they knew. Because of this, this is called the Nahui Olin, the crossing of sticks of new fire. And this was the announcements of the one true God. And in fact, here's an image of the peoples. You see this in the sky right here? This is one of the pictures they wrote to show that there's comets in the sky, there's earthquakes. There's all kinds of crazy stuff going on. They're all like freaking out. Something bad's gonna happen. What's gonna happen? So they were anticipating and waiting for something to happen. And because they had been prophesied that the knowledge of the one true God was going to come back. In fact, Montezuma's sister, Panatsapan, she had a dream less than a week before Cortez's men landed on the shores that there was going to be a ship that was going to arrive that was going to bring the one true God or the knowledge of the one true God, and that it was going to have a shape. She didn't know it was a cross, but it was that she was going to be a shape of a cross. So when they landed, the reason why they didn't say, yay, more people to offer to our false gods and to eat, yay, they didn't say that because they thought, this is the prophecy fulfilled. I only say that because many theologians say they would have killed them. They were a very violent culture, one of the most demonic cultures that have ever existed in our history. Watch the History Channel if you want to know more about the Aztecs and the Mayans. They believe in ritualistic sacrifice. Like, the greatest honor would be to give your child, your first child, as a sacrifice. They'd torture it first, and that'd be a better sacrifice. They were a bloody, weird culture that had all these pagan beliefs, the worship of serpents. Some believe that the devil had really infiltrated that entire culture. So, they were anticipating that this was going to be happening to them. But what happened when this image came to them is they realized, just by looking at a picture, see how it's kind of shaped like a corn on the cob? They knew right away that this was an announcement of something special. Corn was so celebrated in their culture, they would baptize kind of their babies. They would rub corn maize all over their children. And then as a dedication to the gods of their kids, that instead of, you know, being baptized, how'd you like to get rubbed all over with like corn mush? Because that's what they did, because corn was so celebrated. It was their food, it was their staple. You didn't have corn, you died. It was life-giving. So this to them said, this is a life-giving image. And this God being heralded in her womb is greater than the sun god, because she was standing in front of the sun. The Spaniards thought that this was also a very Eucharistic image to them because of the iconography. This is called a mandala, and it shows the union of heaven and earth with divine matter and physical matter. So it was speaking to both civilizations, the Spanish Empire and the Aztec Empire. It also conveyed to the Aztec people that she was greater than their moon god. Their moon god was their second greatest god that offered 80 to 100 sacrifices a year. And she was standing on the moon, conquering the moon. So they knew this god she's heralding is greater than their moon god. But it also spoke to the Spaniards, because we as Catholic Christians know the symbolism of the moon at the lady's feet is the Immaculate Conception image. Because see, none of the, you know, we look in the sky and we see the sun, or we see the moon, it's bright, right? Is there a light source in the moon? Does anybody know why the sun, or excuse me, why the moon has light? Back there. A little louder. Because it just reflects the sun's light, this is Mary. Mary has nothing that we're going to her for. We're going to Mary because she is a reflection of Jesus Christ. All of the goodness and the glory and redemption that Christ is offering us has been revealed to us in Mary, and she is a reflection of that light. But also they knew that she was not declaring herself a god for a couple of reasons. Number one, she's looking down. So she's not looking out. So they knew that the fact that of looking down was a sign of respect in their culture, that she was actually not declaring herself god. It was in her womb, and this was where the god was coming. This life-giving sacrifice to end all of their pagan sacrifice. They would give the blood and the water to create this new civilization of love. She was looking down. So they knew that that was a way that she was declaring it's not herself, but it is this God within her. She also has her knee raised in dancing, actively engaged in worshiping this very God being announced to us. And of course, her hands are in prayer, so the Spaniards knew, this is Mary, and she's worshiping God. Even her pinkies are crossed. It's called the St. Anthony's Cross. And at her throat is a brooch with a cross on it, without a corpus. And Monsignor Eduardo Chavez says that's important because for them to see the crucified Christ at that time, it would have been hard for them to separate out sacrifice, because it wouldn't it look like, well, you guys offer sacrifices, you got a dead body on it, right? So they were saying that part of that was they were living in a culture of great persecution and trying to take people away from these practices and these ancient traditions. It gets hard to break some of the ways that you've been living your life. Hard to break things that you want to stop doing, habits. Anybody suck their thumb when they were little? Anybody suck their thumb when they were little? Come on, you can admit it. All right, anybody have their mom paint their fingernail with something nasty tasting to try to get you to break that habit because you couldn't? Okay, so see, and even then, you would suck it off, right? I'll just suck it off. I'll just suck on it for 15 minutes, it'll taste bad, but it'll be gone and I'll get my thumb back, because that's my husband. My husband sucked his thumb for years. But the point is it's hard for us to break habits. It's hard for us. Even moving, look at that. Sucking on a nookie or sucking on a thumb is hard. So imagine you believe the only way for you to live a life and have what you need to take care of yourself is to do these pagan worships that you've been indoctrinated. This is how you live. And then you have these new people coming in and saying this is wrong. You can't do this anymore. Now you gotta do what we're telling you to do. Like, how do you trust that? So they're really having a hard time with all of this and trying to even believe this. Is this true? Should we be doing this? But they knew that this was coming from the gods, because at her feet, feet, you'll see this winged creature. And the winged creature, and by the way, if you guys are done, I want everybody to come up and take a real good look, because this is a life-size replica. This is exactly the size of the real Tilma. If you would go to Mexico, this is what you would see. And in fact, this one has been touched to the missionary image, so it's a third-class relic, so you can touch it. It's got spiritual graces right here. And they say, because this is the capturing image of Mary, this is how big she really would have been when she was alive. She's just like a little shorter than me. She's just a little thing, ain't she? But the winged creature at her feet is a symbol of the eagles, and the eagle, actually Juan Diego's name was Eagle That Speaks. Remember I told you, names mean everything. And the eagle was symbolic of a messenger from the heavens, a messenger for God, bringing something to the peoples. So they knew that this is a message from the heavens. But we, as Catholic Christians and the Spaniards, would have seen this and said, this is Our Lady of the Apocalypse. This is from John. We're in the Church of St. John. And John has been said when he was doing Mass, when he went into ecstasy, and he had a vision shown to him, that he actually saw Our Lady of Guadalupe. This is the image he saw and wrote about in Revelations, in the woman clothed with the sun, surrounded by stars, with the moon at her feet. Blessed Amadeus. And many other theologians speculate, this is the vision he had, this image right here. So it spoke to the Spaniards and it spoke to the Nahuatl Indians about this new civilization of love. The new civilization of love was depicted in this glyph here. This glyph here is called, this is the water glyph, see the lines that go up? Rooted in the mantle, so they knew the water, the source of the water was going to come from the heavens, divine water and divine life. And here's where that glyph is. And it would be joined with the hill glyph. The hill glyph is this cluster of flowers right here. And the top of it, do you see how it's shaped like a pointy hat of like Pope John Paul's wearing in this image? This is called a bishop's mitre. And so they knew, because inside of the hill glyph, see, here's a pug nose and an eyeball and an eyeball and a little mouth right here. There's a nose and here's the eyes. That was the glyph for a wise man, a shaman, a man of great knowledge outside of this earthly realm. And so they knew that the wise man that was going to tell them about water and hill together means civilization. And it's an upside down heart. So they knew it was going to bring an end to the ritualistic sacrifice of taking her from people's body, because this would be a sacrifice of a new heart that blood and water would flow from, which the new civilization of love would be built upon. And we as Catholic Christians know that that's divine mercy. So here's Juan Diego. The Tilma itself was actually a covering worn on the body, like a coat or a cloak. People would carry their groceries home in it. Just like your stuff in, you roll it up, tie it around your waist. Ladies would carry their babies in their tilmas. Same kind of principle, like an advanced little carrier. You just tie up around yourself. It was a very important piece of clothing. It actually was something that would reveal to anybody who looked at you what your social standing in your class was. I guess it would be kind of like if I've got a pair of boots that look like Uggs, but they don't say UGG on the back. You know that they're not the same, and they cost less, right? That's how they would see it. Oh, your Tilma doesn't have color on it, so you're a lower social class than my family. Just the way your Tilma looked, the coloring, the way that it was and worn on the body, would reveal who you were as a status person. Were you low class? Were you middle class? Were you high society class? It revealed a lot about who you were. This is significant because if God was going to send Mary to give a message to people that he wanted them to know what your God was, your first thought might be to go to the bishop, right? Go to the bishop and especially if you're going to say build a church. Like, how about go to a bishop and tell the bishop to build a church? It'd save a lot of time, wouldn't you think? Like, why go to Juan Diego, who's nobody? Because, like, who's going to believe him? He's just like some random guy in the street, right? But see, that's how good God is he gives us a personal invitation. The Nahuatlanians, the Aztec Empire, were the ones the message was to and for, and for the Spaniards. So you see, the Tilma represents that he came to the very people he was giving the message to. You. I want you. So much so that I'm going to put it right on the very visible outward sign to everyone around you of who you are. And the beautiful color, all of that, was a message. Each and every one of us is just average, normal people, that God will go through any lengths to give us the invitation of love that he's sending through his mother. So the Tilma was worn on the body. This culture of death was in need of something great happening, and St. Juan Diego was the fruits of the Franciscans' conversions. They had been there for almost 10 years, and they weren't really being so successful because, see, sin is in the world. Corruptions in the world. So while it was good when they first got there, they were destroying these pagan altars, they were having holy sacrifices of the Mass, they were reclaiming ground for Christ, they were sharing the truths of the Catholic faith and that they should bring an end to these horrific, cruel sacrifices. But then because of the sin, corruption entered in. Cortes' men began to become very corrupt. They were starting to do horrible things to the people there. And so Bishop Zumarraga was crying out to heaven, and he said, Mary, you gotta get in here and help me out. It is not going well. I'm sure he had a much more beautiful prayer than that, but that's basically the point. I need help here. Maybe that's another good message to all of us, is that we need to stop trying to fix things ourselves, and we need to start asking God to do it for us. Because if we think we're going to change stuff, that's pride. And if you got pride issues, you thinking you're going to change your pride, that's pride. So we need to start trusting and saying, look, you're God. And you can do everything, so y'all better come and do it, okay? Because I need your help. We should be saying that with expectant faith, because he can do that for us. And he wants to do that for us. And he shows us that by coming to St. Juan Diego. What a great devotion to Our Lady. Bishop Zumarraga cried out to heaven, and as St. Juan Diego was walking to church on a Saturday, because he had a great devotion to Mary, he heard these beautiful birds singing on top of this hill. And by the way, there was all kinds of flowers in bloom, and it's in the middle of December. I mean, that would be like our environment, you know, a snow-covered, you know, desert mountain. And walk up on a mountain around here in December and have it like springtime, birds chirping and singing and flowers in bloom. I mean, that in and of itself is a miracle. And this is what happened. And then Mary appeared to him and she says, my little Juanito, I need you to go and tell the bishop to build a church here. So of course he went to the bishop and said, yeah, I saw the Mother of God, you know, son of law, go to church, saw the Mother of God, she told him, we need to build the church. And he said, I'll do it right away. No, he didn't. He said, yeah, right. They didn't believe him. He actually had people follow him, spy on him to see, we'll see what this guy's doing. What is he smoking? Because that ain't not, this guy, something's wrong with him. We need to go see if he's out with those Nahuatl Indians doing stuff he shouldn't be, because something's wrong with this guy. Well, they lost him when they were trying to find him, and they couldn't find out where he went. But when Juan Diego came back, in his tilma, he had all these flowers that Mary had told him to pick and to put into his tilma, and she all rearranged them beautifully. And when he came in, well, the first priests that saw him were like, what do you got there? Because they could smell it. It was just like filling the room, and they're like, where'd you get all those flowers? Like, and they reached in, they tried to grab them, and they disappeared. And they're like, what the heck? Because they just went right into the tilma. And they're like, he's gonna have to see this bishop. You gotta see this guy that we thought was crazy. Like, you gotta see him. And so they rushed him in there. And as he opened the tilma, they all miraculously appeared again. And they fell to the floor. And in that same minute, a Polaroid camera. Anybody see a Polaroid camera? The kinds that immediately press the picture onto and it comes and spits itself out right away? Like, that's what happened. Immediately, boom! an image of Mary appeared on the Tilma right in front of them. And they were like, whoa! And they fell to their knees because they knew, this is a miracle. How did this happen? And a Tilma was like hard and stiff. It was kind of a rough agave cactus plant fiber. And it was smooth as silk. And the colors were illuminated. And it shimmered. And when you moved the picture, it looked like all different colors were coming to life. Which it still does if you go see it in Mexico from different angles. And they knew this was a miracle. And they were like, oh my gosh. This is a sign I was asking for from heaven. But it also, at the same time, Mary had appeared to Juan Bernardino, which was Juan Diego's uncle who was dying, and had miraculously healed him, and also said her name, that she was the Most Holy Mary of Guadalupe. So that's how we know what her name. She didn't give the name to Juan Diego. She gave it to his uncle. And that's significant because he was the oldest of the family. And his purpose was to be the wise man, the leader of the family. So to enter Juan Bernardino into the message of Our Lady of Guadalupe is another message to all of us that our families matter and our families are important. And God desires to have our whole family be invited into this invitation of being reconciled and conversion to come to know, love, and serve him so we can be with him forever in heaven. And the image of Our Lady of Guadalupe is, even to us now, an invitation. It is an image where everything means something. And we know that this is not just something that happened in 1531. This is something that's happening right now. And we know that not just from the glyphs, but the fact that Tilmas were tied together during marriage ceremonies. And it's indicative of wedding. This is it's called theology of the body image. Theology of the body has been given to us at this time in history because it's an antidote to our sick souls that are hurting and broken, not knowing truly what it means to be made male and female. And the gift and the plan that God has for us in that. Because we're all supposed to be an icon of the Trinity. Well, there's some really awesome things that I believe are messages to us now saying, pay attention to the Tilma. This is not just some cool story that's 500 years old. There's miracles that you only now have the science to understand. So do you think in an image where everything means something, that all of these new discoveries mean something? I think they do. The first is we now have the technology to test it. The agave plant fiber, it's almost 500 years old. Has anybody ever put like a piece of food out on the counter and left it there? Or forgot it in your room under your bed on a plate and it's all rotten and moldy? Or a potato? That potato, you know it's there because you can smell it. You know what I'm talking about? There's gotta be a potato that fell out of the potato sack and is in the pantry in the back somewhere because you can smell it. You know what I'm talking about? You look at me like you don't know what I'm talking about. Yes. Alright, some of us know what I'm talking about. This thing should have rotted by now. It's plant fiber. It's organic material. Organic material decomposes. And yet it's 500 years old and it's still in perfectly good shape. It isn't decomposing. Scientists have even tried to replicate the fabric. And the longest that it's ever lasted is 20 or 30 years. It can't be duplicated. Not only that, but we've tested the pigments and the color, and it's neither animal, plant, or mineral. But it was 200 years before synthetic dyes were created, so what is the colors from? How are they there? Then, they spilled nitric acid on it when they were cleaning the frame. Like, I know somebody said, what? How would you spill nitric acid on Our Lady of Guadalupe? Because if you know anything about nitric acid, it burns through everything. Even iron, it melts iron. Like, if you spill it on plant fiber, it's gonna ruin it. And all it did was create a little bit of staining. You can see the staining here. This is from it being spilt, and it didn't destroy it. How is that possible? And now, for whatever reason, my presentation isn't showing this image here, but during a plague that was going in Mexico, they took the image out into the streets and they carried it, and people were miraculously healed, and people, and the plague ended when they asked for Our Lady of Guadalupe's intercession. And one thing that you might have heard of too is the Battle of Lepanto. See all these ships here? The Battle of Lepanto was about 40 years after the original image. They had created a replica of it, and they had painted it, and were sending the very first replica of the image to Europe, because the Pope wanted an image of it. And as they were crossing the ocean, the Islamic armies, like pirates, they would attack ships and take all their cargo. Well, they were being attacked by a group of radical Islamics, and they didn't know what to do, and so they brought the image of Our Lady of Guadalupe from below ship, and they brought it up, and they opened it up, and they pointed the image towards all of the battle scene of being attacked, and they began praying a rosary, and the most unprecedented thing happened. Does anybody know? What happened? Yeah. You raise your hand. Go ahead, just say it. The battle stopped. They surrendered. Now we're watching radical Islamic groups on TV and the news right now. Do they just surrender? No. Their greatest honor and glory is to die in battle. They think that's like the greatest thing they could ever do is to die in the name of Allah. They don't just surrender. Some theologians say this is one of the greatest miracles of Our Lady of Guadalupe that we don't even talk about, because they had aboard their ships, they found. They had just seized several religious ships of missionary priests and religious on their way to the Americas. And had the battle ensued, they all would have drowned and died. But because they surrendered, all of these nuns and priests were saved. It's a miracle. And Our Lady of Guadalupe helped us to protect the church at this particular time, to cure and heal people from the plague. Just the image. And Juan, this is Blessed Miguel Pro in the wars. Vivo Cristo Rey and long live Our Lady of Guadalupe. That was the then mantra of Mexico. And they would carry banners of Our Lady of Guadalupe in the streets. The blast trying to destroy the image was so hot in 1921 that it melted steel and it destroyed marble and it broke the windows out of buildings nearby, but not a scratch on the Tilma, and nobody was there for the mass was hurt. So an image where everything means something, we have to ask ourselves, does this mean something? And I believe that it does. So let's take a look real quick at some of the new discoveries. That's Christopher Columbus, since he used to have a devotion to Our Lady of Guadalupe in Spain. All right, so here we go, the new discoveries. It's a topographical map of Mexico. All of the water glyphs and all of the hill glyphs can be aligned over the cities and the hills and the waterways of Mexico, and they align exactly. Why? Why is it a map of Mexico? There's music in the Tilma. There's an actual musical composition. When you look at all the stars and all of the glyphs on the inside, it lines up on a sheet of music, and it's an actual musical composition. In her eye behaves as a living eye. It's called the Samson-Purkinje effect. And there's images of 14 people in her eyes, one of which is a family. See, there's a mother with a baby on her back, children around her, and a husband with a sombrero on it. There's a family in her eyes. Not only that, Juan Diego is in her eye. There's a picture of Juan Diego back here. And the bishop and his servant and someone else in the room, 14 people, using high-powered microscopes we have found, are in her eye. Why? Why was that hidden there? What does it mean? And did you know the constellations as they appeared in the morning sky in 1531 from the exact latitude and longitude? Tilma, and their exact placement. And we needed advanced Kepler's mathematics and NASA software to find that out. Why? Why is that there? I mean, we can understand out, for instance, in the Corona Borealis being the crown constellation at her head. Okay, so she's crowned. Well, she is. We do call her Queen of Heaven and Earth. And the Virgo constellation is at her heart. We do call her the Queen and the Virginal Heart and the Immaculate Conception. And even Hydra the serpent is crawling up her belly, and that's from Revelations, that the serpent wants to devour the child. But what we haven't had a conversation about is the fact that Draco the dragon constellation is right underneath her gaze, the head of the dragon, as if her eyes are looking into the eyes of the dragon. And the dragon is talked about in the Bible as the one that brings division, schism, lies. We're being lied to. God, our Father, loves us so much, and he's a plan for us. And even when our own human fathers fail us, because they will, because none of us are perfect and we all fall short. My parents divorced when I was 3 months old, so I lived and grew up without a father. And I had a lot of abuse in my life. So the fathers or the father figures that did come into my life, the lie was there planted by the evil one that I can't trust God or that God abandoned me. And I was healed of that lie. Because all of these lies are trying to separate us from being in a relationship with God who loves us, who's constantly giving us miracles because he wants us to know how much he loves us, how much he wants to be in relationship with us, how much he wants to heal our hearts, how much he wants to be our best friend when people fail us, when parents even fail us. He wants us to go to his mother and to his father. Jesus wants us to. And the scorpion is talked about in the Bible as the one that brings great wounds to us, especially in what it means to be a male and to be female. And Mary helps to rectify that. So we see that some call it the demonic trinity, that forms like an inverted angle, triangle over us. But what Mary is telling us through all these apparitions, because we have so many apparitions that come to us. How many of you have seen The Truman Show? Because that's where I'm going to end. I'm going to end with The Truman Show. This was a presentation I gave last night. We're called to be in a relationship. Wow, I use a lot of pictures of that. Sorry about that. Let's see, come on, where are you, Truman? There he is. Oh, Matrix, that's the wrong one. I was looking at that. How many of you seen The Truman Show? Good movie, isn't it? So what's The Truman Show about?
It's about this guy who's, his entire life is just like a TV show, and he doesn't know it, so he's in sleep. So, and all of his friends were actors, and he starts to see things that are like suspicious, and he finally finds out that his whole life was a TV show, and that his friends were really just all actors, and yeah.
And they even like put posters up that says like there's a plane crashing, being struck by lightning theme at the travel agency. Like imagine going to a travel agency to go travel somewhere. There's a picture of a plane being struck by lightning and crashing, saying it could happen to you. Like, oh, I'm not going to travel. They would do deliberate things to scare him so he wouldn't try to leave this island he believed he was on. See, this is what's happening to us, folks. The TV and this reality around us is telling us that this is what's real, and we have lost the ability to understand that there is supernatural things going on in the world. That there is a whole entire spiritual reality. And this is why all of this is here. She's waking us up. She's trying to say, there's something going on here. There is a spiritual reality. And if you had spiritual eyes to see, you would see right now in this room, standing, guarding you right now is a guardian angel. And ain't no little prissy thing with wings. This is a huge, majestic creature. Like 10, 12 feet tall is what some of the theologians and saints who have seen their guardian angels have said. They're huge, majestic beings, and his whole purpose is to guard you, to protect you, to guide you, to help to form your conscience, to get you to heaven. That's his job. And all of us are surrounded by angels right now. We're never alone. St. Padre Pio said, if we could see how many devils there are, the world seeking the ruin of souls, they would cloud out the light of the sun they are so many. And I'm not saying that to scare you. I'm saying we need to wake up. There is a spiritual reality, and we as Catholic Christians have more weapons than any of our other Christian brothers and sisters, because we have the sacraments and we have the sacramentals, and these are powerful weapons as a church militant, which was the word we used to use for Catholic Christians, church militant. The church in heaven is a church triumphant. The church of purgatory is a church suffering, and we're supposed to be working together to bring souls out of darkness with our love to Jesus Christ so they can fulfill their purpose and do something great for God. But that's the power of free will. God doesn't come and kick in our doors. He gives us, issues us gentle invitations. Even miracles to show us that we matter and that he longs for us. He thirsts for us. He doesn't want to shoot us with lightning bolts. He wants to fill our hearts. He wants us to overflow with grace. He wants us to come to Mary and ask her to consecrate ourselves to her so we can stand mystically in between her and the Holy Spirit, so that we can be healed, so that we can be filled, so that we can bring that out into a hurting world, to receive it for ourselves, to conceive it within us, and then to birth that into something great with our lives. So I want to end our presentation today, and I want you to see if you can come up and just come and look at the image as you leave, with a song to the Holy Spirit, the spouse of Mary, and ask for the Holy Spirit to fill us and to guide us and to show us how holy water, holy salt, wearing a scapular, wearing a miraculous medal, blessing ourselves, asking our parents for blessings. If your parents are having problems in their marriage, you can pray for them. By virtue of the blood running in your veins, you have authority to pray a blessing over your parents. You can even say, in the name of Jesus, I bind any spirits that might be attacking my parents right now. You can do that. You have authority because the blood in your veins runs in their veins, and that's God's covenantal blessing of family. We have everything we need to win this battle, young people. And the world is going to get a more difficult and hostile place. And this should be your sanctuary. This should be the place where we're loving one another. We should not be fighting amongst ourselves. We have a battle to win. And Mary is building up an army of laid down lovers to go into the darkness to bring in the lost bride. And she's asking you to sign up. So close your eyes. I'm going to say a prayer to the Holy Spirit.
Let me only
Our Lady of Guadalupe, pray for us. St. Juan Diego, pray for us. St. John the Evangelist, pray for us. Our Lady Help of Christians, pray for us. Our Lady of Good Help,